Welcome everyone to another episode of Coaching in Session. My name is Michael Raritan, and today we have a special treat. So we're going to just have a recap of my time on the Limitless Show today. So we're going to be watching that video, and then we're going to be closing out the stream for today. It is a long video, but there's a lot of great content. We're talking about several of my blogs that I wrote and just giving my perspective on the topics and just a general overview of mindset. A great conversation, always, with Anshu Todi.
Hello, everyone. Welcome to The Limitless Show. Thank you so much for joining me here from LinkedIn, Facebook, YouTube, and my Limitless tribe. We were all created equal in God's eyes, the Bible says, but in this world, our worth differs based on how much of our potential we have explored and realized. It is said that our wealth and success is directly proportional to how much value we have created for others. Through this show, I constantly strive to create a window through which you can look into the minds of such people who have understood the fundamentals of manifesting abundance in their life by adding massive value to others. With every show, even if you take away one such key fundamental and implement it in your own life, no one can stop you from being limitless. My today's guest, Michael Raritan, was born in Connecticut, USA. It's a small state that is adjacent to New York. He realized that he wanted to be a teacher when he got a job being a swimming coach. And when he was like 5 years in the same thing, that was the time he left to focus on his teaching career. And then he graduated with master's in 2013. And he started teaching in the public school system from kindergarten to 12th grade. And last 2 years of his teachings were focused on working with students with special needs. Now, Michael founded his company, Reven Concepts, in 2018. And the reason he started his company is due to the need for stronger mindset that needs to be created, because he saw a big gap. You know, he saw that the school system were formulating a major flaw in the mindset. And that was the whole reason people were losing their ability to understand their own self-worth. So let's bring Michael on the show with a big round of applause. Hey, Michael, thank you for joining me here on the show. And it's great to have you over here.
Thank you so much, Anshu, for bringing me on. It's a pleasure.
Wonderful. So, Michael, we always begin the show with the guests sharing their journeys with the audience so that, you know, they are able to relate to, you know, where you have been and how far you have come.
Sure. So I was born in Bridgeport, Connecticut. And Bridgeport, if you ever look it up, is not going to be the most glamorous of places. So it's the ghetto. And a lot of violence, drugs, gangs, name it, they have it, right? So I had that type of upbringing. And it wasn't necessarily a positive type of upbringing. It had their own struggles, you know, just living there. But you can either let your environment define you or refine you. And so the environment wasn't going to take a hold of me, right? I wasn't going to continue with that type of environment because it wasn't the life that I wanted in the end for myself. So I didn't want to be in a gang. I didn't want to be selling drugs or just have all that type of negative behavior and lifestyle. So I decided to get out. And so I went to school, got an education, went all the way up to college, got my master's degree in education, started teaching. Mm-hmm. And just from there, it started the whole effect of, okay, I really enjoy teaching. I really enjoy helping others. And I saw the discrepancies where the school system was creating people who were not going to be 100% ready for society. So mm-hmm. Yes, they're able to do math, English, you know, be able to write and speak, but at the same mm-hmm. time, are they able to make the choices they need for their best life? And mm-hmm. in college, they are so afraid to fail, but they're not worried so much about succeeding because the world is around, you know, because the world around them at the time is like, all right, if I mess up, you know, this is my life and that's going to be my life. And there's so much more than worrying about failure. And so what I do as a mindset coach is taking away that failure aspect, right? Because failure is probably the best lessons you will ever have in your life. So don't be afraid to have a failure. Be afraid to not have them so much, in the sense where those failures help you grow. So all in all, just helping people understand how much power they have, right? Similar to what you do, being limitless. You have so much more potential and you have so much more to give every single day. And whether you give it or if you don't, that's up to you.
Yes, absolutely. So true. So mindset is a much used word, Michael, in today's world. I think 5 years back or 10 years back, we never used to hear mindset so much. Of course, I mean, there were books, there still were people who were talking about it, but it had not come really to the masses. So now that, you know, on a mass level, we are speaking about mindset, and a general person kind of wonders, what is this mindset all about? Is it like just the mind, the brain that we are talking about? And, you know, why should I worry about a mindset? How does it help me? So could you explain more in detail for a person who really does not know what a mindset is all about and how we can tap into that mindset and get benefited?
Okay, yes, sure. So your mindset is going to be your overall general thinking of any particular situation. So let's talk about life first. So how do you view your life? Do you view it as just, all right, I'm here, I'm doing what I'm doing, and that's it? Or do you operate on the standpoint of, okay, I'm here, but there's so much more for me? And it's similar to having the idea of, is your glass half full or half empty, right? Are you pessimistic? Are you optimistic? Do you have this much more to give, or do you have this much missing? So your mindset is going to be focused more so on how you're thinking, how you're operating. Because if you have a positive mindset, for example, you're going to be more optimistic, right? You're going to believe in yourself more. You're going to go after more than you would if you had maybe a pessimistic mind. Because if you were more pessimistic, you might say, well, why should I even bother? What is the point of me doing this? Because, you know, it's just going to end with me losing, right?
Yes.
And people get into that mindset because of failures, because of their environment, or just because of what's going on in the world. If we take a look at the world, what's happening right now with the whole quarantine, vaccines, and everything like that, how many people are putting themselves on hold? How many people are putting their lives on pause because, whether the government, whether people are saying you can't go out, you can't do this, it's a limiting factor, right? So you're being limited. And if you allow that limiting to happen in your life, then you're basically telling your mind, your mindset is going to be, my life is limited. There's only so much I can do. So if you have that type of mindset, then you're going to operate at a lower efficiency. So what I do and what other mindset coaches should be doing is helping you operate at a higher efficiency level, where your mindset is not going to be so much focused on, okay, what can't I do, but what can I do, right? We look for the solutions and the problems. And the way it helps you is that you get to go after more in your life, because people fail to understand that we're only here for a finite amount of time, right? We're not going to be living forever. The last time I checked, there's no cure for everlasting life. So you have so many years, you have so many minutes left on this earth. And I was telling my father, I was speaking with him, and I live in Texas. He still lives in Connecticut. And I said, okay, well, how many times do I visit you, right? So if, let's say I visit my father every year. Right. And my father is almost 60. And let's say he has maybe 20 more years to live. So he's going to pass away when he's 80. So I told him, I said, that means we only have 20 more times to see each other. And that kind of woke him up, because he was like, wow, only 20 more times to see my kid, right? To see my son. And that made him start to think, right? Because when you start to understand that time is is fleeting. It's not so much where you're worried about not having enough time, but understanding that you're going to make the time you have valuable. Right. And so your mindset is going to be, what can you do right now? How can you progress, right? Can you be better tomorrow, right? Like, yes. The goal should always be to be better than you are today.
Absolutely.
So
mindset is basically, let me understand. So if you have a positive mindset, if you have a mindset of looking at the glass as half full, then you always try to achieve more. You always go for more because you have hope in your heart and you have that positivity, which makes you try new stuff and go for better goals. But when you're negative, of course, you just stop yourself in where you are because you feel that, you know, what's the use? Mm-hmm. You might not achieve whatever you're going for.
Yeah. And I wouldn't say always, because you can have a wonderful mindset and then there can be something that happens in your life that just kind of knocks you down. And right. It's not so much about getting knocked down is the problem. It's about, do you get back up? Right. Yes. Like, how often do you get back up? How quick do you get back up? And trauma is one of the reasons why people change, right? Whether it be a death in family, loss of job, something happens to your body, whether you lose the ability to walk, talk, etc. That type of trauma is actually going to affect you where you're going to say, well, now I can't do something. And then your mindset is going to be negative, right? It's going to say, okay, well, I can't do this because of this, right? Of your circumstances. Mm-hmm. So being able to go past your circumstances, right? So for me, growing up, I didn't have the best neighborhood to grow up in, but I didn't let that type of upbringing say, well, this is my life, right? I'm not going to allow that to affect what I'm able to accomplish. And I see that in many people. Many people are defined by their circumstances, by their environment. Yes. And if they can get past that and they can say, well, I want to be there, and they do what they need to do to get there, that's important. Because if they're going to simply say, okay, I want to be more positive, I want to have a positive mindset, that's very nice, but that's only operating at the surface level. Because we need to get deep. We need to understand, well, what's the reason, right? What is the root cause for you not being able to think in a more optimistic way, right? Just to use a word. And then a synonym would be positive, right? To say, okay, well, I can do this, right? And it's taken away from us at a young age where kids are superheroes and they're jumping off the sofa and they believe they can do anything. And then it only takes one time, right, for them to get knocked down, and then they're afraid to get back up. And that fear is going to stop you, right? They say that fear is going to be the number one dream killers that you'll ever have to face. And if you can overcome the fear that's going to be coming into your life, then you're going to be able to overcome the challenges that are along the way, because life is not going to be without its problems. So just having a mindset that understands that there's going to be problems, there's going to be hard times, there's going to be ups and downs, but you take the good and the bad. Yeah. And you always should say, okay, well, the bad is there, but the good is here too.
Yes. And how resilient I can be in that situation.
Exactly.
I think resilience is what we require every time we fall down, every time we face a trauma. What helps us get up is the resilience to it.
Yes, totally agree. If you're not resilient, then all the negativity, especially in today's world, is going to weigh very heavy on you. And a lot of people are struggling right now because they feel like the world's on top of them. When the case is, your world is just not controlled by you.
Yes.
So people are allowing their world, right, their life, to dictate what's possible for them. Yes. And they have to get out of that thinking, get out of that habit, because if they don't, they're going to be crushed by their thinking, by their way of living, and they're not going to be truly able to live.
True. So we just spoke about, I think, you know, you said that just trying to be positive, you can be positive for some time, but that's not going to be lasting because it's happening on a surface level. So that brings me to my next question. I think, when we talk about the resolving any issue from that depth, we always talk about subconscious mind. They say that we have three minds, the subconscious mind, the conscious mind, and the unconscious mind. Would you like to, take us through, what kind of function do all the three have and what kind of impact they have on our lives?
Sure. So the conscious mind is going to be the surface level, right? So that's going to be how we think, how we talk, and how we act. So looking at our conscious mind is going to be our choices. So we're going to, let's say, wake up in the morning and we're going to go to the gym. So now we're at the gym, we have a good workout, we come home. Okay, what's the next thing we do, right? Do we go to work? We go to work, okay. We do our day-to-day at work, then we come home. But what do we do when we get home? Do we continue working? Do we start building our empire? Do we just kind of say, well, work was very difficult, and say, okay, well, I'm just going to, sit on the sofa today, and I'm just going to watch some TV and relax because I had a very stressful day, right? So the conscious mind is just there telling you how to operate. And then we have our subconscious mind. The subconscious mind is going to be that whisper, that small voice that's trying to say, hey, you have more to give. Like, don't give up yet. Yes. It's going to be telling you the truth, right? It's going to be your belief.
Yes.
And the subconscious mind is going to say in the morning, okay, so you wake up, you go to the gym. Well, I mean, you've been going to the gym for 3 months and you didn't lose any weight. So what's the point, right? Then you go to work, you're just like, you don't even like this job. The only reason you're here is for a means to the end or to pay your bills. So like, what are you doing? Like just go through your day and just wait for Friday and then dread Monday. And then when you get home, the subconscious mind is saying, oh, okay, I'm stressed out and I just need to take a break. And I'm not going to push myself because I'm going to break if I push myself anymore. And that is going to be your belief, right? Where you're going to say, well, I can't push myself because I'm already so stressed and I don't see the results. Then you have your unconscious mind where it's going to be just you waking up in the morning, and whether you do it or you don't do it, it's going to be because of a habit. Whether you go to work and you do it because you enjoy it, and whether you come home, do you follow your regular habits or do you create new habits that are going to be more beneficial to you? Right. So all of them play a role and all of them need to be addressed. So that's all just talking about the three. Now, when we are talking about motivation, that's going to be your conscious mind and that's going to be the top, right? So if I gave you a piece of cake or a cupcake, it has the frosting and the sprinkles. That's going to be just dealing with the frosting and the sprinkles. And it tastes good, but the reason why you have a cupcake is the cake part. And so we really want to dive down to that cake, which is going to be your subconscious mind. Right. And if the cake is bad, if the cake is dry, you're not going to enjoy the cupcake overall. Yeah. So having a positive subconscious mind that's geared to helping you succeed, that's geared to helping you achieve greater heights in your life, that's going to be key and essential for you to progress, because your conscious mind, again, it's just the superficial part. Think of if you go to a motivational seminar, everyone's like, hoorah, you could do it. Give me 120%. You can do this tomorrow. You're going to be a millionaire. Say, yes, I can. Yes, I can. That's the conscious mind, right? The conscious mind is easily influenced. It can be easily manipulated, but the subconscious mind is always there. The subconscious mind is going to say, but remember yesterday you said you're going to be a millionaire and then you woke up, you weren't a millionaire today. And it starts to believe that, right? It says, well, it happened before and you said it was going to happen. It didn't happen. And the more negative reinforcement it gets, it's going to say, well, I'm just going to be negative. And you could sway it to be positive where you're a dreamer and live in a fantasy world where you're saying, well, I didn't get it yesterday, but I'm going to lie to myself and I'm going to say I'm going to get it tomorrow. But what work, right? What work are you doing to get there, right? That's your conscious work. And then your belief, whether you're going to get it in your unconscious work is, or your unconsciousness is going to be saying, okay, am I really, really doing what needs to be done? Because your habits are going to reflect that.
Yes. Absolutely. So, Michael, when you were in the public schools, when you were teaching, were there any incidences that happened that made you feel very, very strongly about this mindset part that, mm-hmm. you know, it really needed to be addressed, that, you know, the kids were not getting mm-hmm. the right mindset? What were the certain incidences or any such situations that popped up in front of you that actually made you take the decision of becoming a mindset coach later in your life?
Yes. So there's two examples that ring out to me. One was when I was a swim coach, and I was still doing swimming when I was teaching mm-hmm. for probably a year or two. And then I left swimming to just focus on teaching. Mm-hmm. One of the instructors was having a student come for like a makeup lesson. And she was busy with another student, you know, with another student, and I had some availability in my schedule. So she asked if I would be able to take on her student. And I said, sure, not a problem. I don't mind. And from, you know, in my initial inspection of him, making sure he can swim, he was a very strong swimmer, wonderful swimmer. And so I'm like, okay, well, you know, let's get, you know, a little bit more challenging. So we go into the deep end, and he's afraid of the deep end. So he doesn't want to swim in the deep end, even though he knows how to swim. He's like, I'm afraid, I can't do this. So the instructor comes to me and she says, don't even bother, he can't do it. And I said, he can't do it. And I was like, okay. And right there, it was automatically challenge accepted, because if he couldn't do it, then how is he able to swim over here, right? He's able to swim on the shallow side, but why can't he swim the deep side? And that's just a fear, right? That's just an obstacle that he has to get over. So from there, at that point, I had about 20 minutes left of the lesson. And I said, I'm going to devote these next 20 minutes to getting this young man to swim. And so that's what we did, right? We started baby steps. We started just on the wall, on the deep end. We're not going to the little end. And we just started working, right? So he was just jumping off the wall to me, right? Just doing one kick, two kicks, then some arms. And so he's doing basically what I teach two-year-olds how to do. And he's about six, right? So right. He already has an obstacle, that block in his mind. Okay. So eventually, I get him to swim across the whole pool, right? A lot of hard work. I'm like tired and he's tired, but we get it done. And just on time too. So after the lesson, I told him, and I it was kind of like a whisper almost, but I made sure the teacher heard too. I was like, don't you ever allow anybody to limit your life. Don't ever allow anyone to say you can't do something because you can. And then I gave him his playtime. And the mom came up to me and she was like, oh my God, thank you so much. And she was wondering if I could be his instructor. And I said, thank you so much for the compliment, but I was already booked. And then she goes, rightfully so. And right. I was like, yeah, but he's fine now. And so just that little tidbit. And then in the school system, we have our students going to different grades, right? So we have like our elementary school, middle school, high school. And mm-hmm. in each of the different realms or in the different grades, you have different types of development. And so when you have students who are getting into middle school, that's where you see the hormones raging and you start to see their minds go more into the set. They operate on the premise where they believe they know everything. And that's fine. I mean, if you believe you know everything, that's fine. Let me try to teach you something new. And so it's a lot of peer pressure going on. And when someone is stubborn, right, when someone is under the idea that they don't need you or that they know everything and that they're going to mm-hmm. be satisfied, then guess what? They're not mm-hmm. going to be open to listen to what someone has to say, right? They're not going yes. to be receptive. Yes. So if that's the case, why would a student listen to a teacher? So now these teachers are like, well, what's the point? Because if there's no point in them learning from me, what am I even doing? So the teachers get tenured. They can teach whatever. If the kids learn, great. If the kids don't learn, not a problem. They can stay back or we'll just push them just to get them out of our hair. And I saw that. And the kids can fail. And the parents will actually go into the school and say, why did my kid fail? And you can show them the test. You can give examples to the parent saying, okay, this is what I would require from your child. Mm-hmm. And he's not able to do it. Mm-hmm. So, and then they're like, I don't understand. I'm like, okay, well, what's 5 plus 5? And they're like, that's 10. Okay. Then I'll give them another answer. Right. But this one is very difficult. And I was like, okay, well, what's the square root of, 180? I don't know. That's why they got the F, because they didn't know the required information. So the parents will fight, because even if you explain that to them, they're like, oh, no. My child is smart, right? My child is special. They're entitled. So they are going to have their parents fight their battles for them. And now we're having a new generation that's coming up where they feel entitled, right? Where they feel like, oh, my mom is going to protect me. My dad is going to protect me. My grandma, grandpa is going to protect me, right? I am sheltered, right? They're very coddled. And they have a very weak mindset because they never had to deal with that type of adversity, with that type of difficulty, right? For me, when I was young, if I failed the test, my mom mm-hmm. and dad were on me. They weren't on my teacher. They were on right. me. And right. and now the parents are on their teachers, where yes. where they're saying the teacher is the problem. And then now where do teachers fight, right? They say, well, the parents are just going to get their way if they fight hard enough. So, I mean, I'm just going to give them a grade so they pass, whether it's a C or an A, yes. doesn't matter to me. But as long as they yes. move on to the next grade, they're out of my hair. So yeah. now it's not so much teachers are taking the full responsibility, like they're not ready to move on to the next grade. So I'm going to keep him here so he's ready for what's coming for him or her.
Yes.
And that's a discrepancy that's happening in the school system. And I'm not saying that every teacher does that, right? There's going to be teachers that fight and saying, no, this is going to be the case. But I've seen some wonderful teachers who had good hearts, who were on top of their game. And right. I've seen the principal go to the teacher and say, listen, I understand that you have all this information and things like that, but do you want to deal with this headache? And that's the parent, right? Do you really want to deal with this headache? And the principal is saying that to the teacher. And the teacher's like, okay, well, whatever, right? And then the kid passes. The kid moves on. The kid gets the A. And yes. it's crazy. It's crazy. So I wasn't going to be a part of that type of system. And I'm sure it doesn't happen in every school. But I've seen it happen in the schools that I've taught multiple times.
No, it completely resonates with me, Michael. Unfortunately, I mean, you are sitting in the US and I'm in India, mm-hmm. but it happens here as well. In fact, a few of my aunts have been teachers. They are still teachers. And the kind of system they have is like, please the parents, please the students. Mm-hmm. The students come from maybe affluent backgrounds and they are paying high fee. The school, all the school wants is that fee to keep recurring every year. Mm-hmm. And they do not want the teachers to be strict with the students. They do not want them to call a tomato a tomato. I mean, they just want basically teachers to take all the pressure and all the negative feedback for the students' performance. Even if the student is not studying anything, it's the entitlement mindset, as you mm-hmm. already spoke about it. They are teaching these students that entitlement, that you are entitled to good scores or whatever. If you are not getting it, it's the teacher's mistake. It's not your mistake at all. Mm-hmm. So that does happen. Yes, it's happening even now. And I think it's a part of, we are growing into a sick society if we are letting that happen. Mm-hmm. And the students are going to anyhow go on the wrong way, because mm-hmm. definitely they cannot grow up to become responsible citizens.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's definitely more political than anything, because yeah. when I was a teacher, they would implement these new testing into school. So every grade from first to 12th grade will have this new type of testing mm-hmm. where they'll see where the students were on like where their education was, right? Their educational level. Mm-hmm. And the reason why they did it wasn't so much to identify if they were on, the right grade, was because, okay, if they score well, the school gets more money.
That's
so, awesome. So it's totally political, where it's like, okay, if your kids get, you know, if the students get good grades, we'll give the school more money. So, but then what about the areas where kids have a rough type of upbringing, right? Whether they're dealing with domestic abuse at home, if they don't have a home to go to, maybe no power, no heat, and just simply understanding that aspect of it, mm-hmm. then you're going to say, well, how's that fair where the high earning schools, right, might be the affluent kids, and then the low earning schools will be the kids who grow up in the ghettos or from a poor neighborhood. How's that fair, right? Like, where are we going to bring society when we keep the middle class or the lower middle class where they are, and then the upper middle class or, you know, the elite few are going to be exactly where they are, right? But what's happening is that the middle class are just dropping down to the lower classes, you know, into poverty. And it's not so much that they're unable to do it, it's just that their environment has been telling them that this is what was allotted for me. And we have to get out of that. So the school system, I love, you know, like I love the idea of it. And there's many wonderful teachers, but at the same time, if politics are going to remain in the school system, it's going to continue to be the same recurring problems where schools focus on getting funding for whatever they need, and parents can fight for the education of their kids, or they can say the kid is responsible for their grade. But as long as that discrepancy remains there, the children are always going to get the short end of the stick, because they need to learn to fight for themselves. They need to learn how to go through this type of adversary type of mentality that they're going to be faced with in the school system. And I remember one time I was in Connecticut, and I was taking a lift from my parents' house, and I was going to the gym, I believe. And I was talking to the driver, and I was telling him I was a mindset coach. And he said one of the best things that happened to him in school was that he was bullied. And it wasn't so much where he enjoyed being bullied, but he said it helped him understand that, okay, I was bullied, and then to rise from that, right? So he wasn't a victim, but he was a person who can get out of that type of victim mentality. And in our current world, everyone's a victim, right? If we look at, you know, just the vaccines, like they're saying, if you don't have the vaccine, then you are the problem, right? My vaccine doesn't work because you don't have the vaccine. So they're a victim to someone else. Yes. And as long as people have that type of mentality in their mind, they're going to continue with that type of negative behavior throughout their life. And they're always going to say, this is the reason why I don't have something. And if you believe that's the case and you're not the reason because you don't have something, will you ever get it? And it's possible that you can. That's going to be luck. But we shouldn't base our life on luck. We should base it on the premise of, I'm able to accomplish this, and then I'm going to go after and get it.
Yes, definitely. We create our destinies rather than, you know, wait for it to happen, because it might not happen.
Correct.
Absolutely. So in one of your blogs, I understand that you do a lot of blogging on your website. And I came across a very interesting blog where you talk about, you know, that obedience is for women and not for men, where you talk about the mindset differences between both the sexes and also their roles and accountabilities. So why don't you share it with us, with the audience, as to, you know, what was your take when you did your, I think you did some kind of a survey with a certain set of men and women. So what was your takeaway on this obedience thing and the mindset thing?
So right now in our world, we're having an issue with men and women not wanting to get married or stay married, where this is more so maybe a Western type of way of thinking, but it's going to be over a general basis of, okay, who's able to accomplish what in their life. So there was a time when women would stay at home and they would only work, take care of the kids. And then eventually they said, you know, I want to work, right? I want to vote. And they fought for that and they got it. And there's more power to them, right? I'm all for equal rights. I'm all for them being able to accomplish whatever they want to have in their life. Yes. But when you are going after a relationship, there has to be some type of balance. And if we look at the traditional roles where a man protects and provides, and we look at the roles of the traditional wife, where she is the caretaker of the kids in the home, both are roles that are very stressful, right? And by no means am I saying a stay-at-home wife is an easy job. It is not.
Not at all.
Especially when you have to deal with children, taking care of everything. If you have to cook, clean, that's a lot of work. And same is true for the male perspective, where he may be stressed at work, right? And he has to make sure he doesn't lose his job because he has to provide for his family. So there's two types of stresses. And it doesn't necessarily matter if the man stays at home or if the woman stays at home, but there has to be balance, right? So if the woman wants to be the breadwinner, you know, she can. But if the man wants to be the breadwinner and the woman wants to be a breadwinner, there could be some type of imbalance. And if you make enough money, you can hire a babysitter. But then at some point, you have to understand, do you want someone raising your kids or do you want to raise your own children?
Yes.
So when I was asking, so when I was asking everyone about the different areas, because we talk about lifestyle, career, et cetera, I was really driving the point of, what would be your most ideal type of situation? And the woman I spoke with, college educated woman, and these are women who are making, you know, six figures easily. So I was curious. I was like, would you be willing to give that up? And they said, for the right man, yes, I would be willing to give that up. And asking that of the same type of men who are driven, this is key, driven to make high amounts of money or earn a high monetary value or amount. They said, I would rather work. Where they're like, they would rather be the breadwinners. And this is for the higher, you know, masculine type of men. But when given the option, okay, someone has to stay at home with the kids.
Yes.
Right? Men are very stubborn, very stubborn. They said, well, that's the wife's job, right? The majority said that. And when I asked the wife, and I was like, this man does everything for you, right? He's paying all your bills. He's giving you everything you want, the vacations you want. He's taking care of the kids. The only thing you have to do is stay at home, take care of the house, clean. That's it. Right. The majority of women said, I would rather have that. So that's where the obedience part came in. Right. Where it's like, OK, they have that ability to go out and earn a high amount of money, but they would rather let the man take control. And what I see is with some of my clients who are going through divorce or separation, they're dealing with women who have a subconscious belief in their mind that they have told themselves over and over again, right? So it was a rhetoric that they said, oh, my man is not masculine enough, or my man doesn't make enough money for me to live a lifestyle, or I have to work a certain amount of hours. I would rather just stay at home with the kids. And I understand the whole modern woman movement because it gives them the type of freedom and the independent nature they could have to not need a man. But at the same time, when you're older, right, and you're in your 30s, you want someone to spend your life with. You want someone to grow with and someone who's going to respect you, right? Because being a single parent is not easy. And when faced with the option to be able to settle with a person who's going to be able to give you everything you're looking for or to continue to fight alone, women would tended to settle when it comes to in a relationship between heterosexual couples. So all in all, the obedience part is more for the woman in the sense of they're more willing to compromise because men are more stubborn. But if a man decided to be more feminine and say, I would stay at home with the kids and I'll take care of everything and I'll cook, that's fine. But there has to be balance. It's type of the yin and the yang, the good and the bad. So in a relationship, you shouldn't have masculine, masculine. You should have masculine, feminine. And if someone is not going to be feminine, right? So let's say the man doesn't want to be feminine, the woman doesn't want to be feminine. That's where the problems arise. And that's where people say, you know what? I'm not going to be in this relationship because this person is not giving me what I want, right? The entitlement. And they're saying, they're not giving me what I want and what I need. So I'm going to leave and find someone who's going to give me what I'm looking for. And at the primal level, right, of how we grew as, you know, in just the, you know, as humans, right? Our current species is only around 100,000 years old. Right. And we went from hunter-gatherers to living in houses with running water, and we don't, and going to the grocery store. So we necessarily don't have to go through that type of struggle. But when women chose mates back then, they chose men who were able to protect and provide for them, right? They were able to go out, procure food, and procure the safety of themselves and the family. And now we have a bunch of modern women who are able to go out and do this for themselves, where they don't necessarily need to worry about safety, but at the same time, are they equal in the sense of the strength of a man? And that's not the case, because if we look at this whole transgender problem we're having, there was a UFC fight where there was a transgender male. He was in the army, and he was going against a female who was not transgender, and he demolished her, right? Because the levels of strength were so vastly different. So in the sense of body composition, we're not equal, right? I am not able to, I'm not able to have a kid, right? You are able to have a child. As much as I want, as much as I dream and pray, I am not able to bear a child. I'm able to assist in making a child, but not give birth to one, right? So So what's happening, I believe, with the whole modern woman type of thing also, is that they believe that, well, I'm just not going to have relations with a man because he needs me. Because he needs me to carry on the human race. Well, yeah, we need you to give birth and to carry on the human race, yes. But at the lower level is, what do you want too? And most women want to have relationships, right? Especially when they're in the 28 to 36 age range, where they're done with the whole, okay, I tried this and... All right, I had my fun. I went on a few dates. I found some jerks in my life, and I found some really nice guys in it. So I'm going to stick with a really nice guy. And just understanding that phase, so from 18 to 26, is your kind of your play phase. You're not serious about a relationship, and relationships could happen. But more so in your 28 to 36, you're more worried about your biological clock, right? Women are more worried about their biological clock. Men can have kids 365 days or more a year. So so we can have that many kids, or however times we're able to produce the resources needed to have a baby. But a woman is only able to have a child to term one time, you know, once a year. So understanding that, it's like, would you rather have someone who's going to be obedient and say, okay, I'm going to have a select few men have my most intimate part of my being, or I'm going to be promiscuous and just kind of flounder myself? And so when we talk about obedience, it's more so of loyalty and of being able to understand that I'm going to follow someone. I'm going to be led by someone I trust, someone I care for. And modern women are definitely making poor choices when it comes to men, because they're either dealing with feminine men, or they're dealing with men who have no ambition or no drive. Right? They have a very poor mindset. And women fail to understand that men control relationships, but women control sexual access. So now that the modern women are here and they can go out and they can get a man and do that, now they don't really control sexual access anymore because they want the same thing as what the man wants. So now the man is getting this type of relations without even having a committed relationship. Yes. So now it's kind of up in the air, right? Where if women are going to be going after just relationships, and then eventually they say, well, I want a relationship now, men are already under the premise of, well, why do I need to give you a relationship if I want it to have relations with you and I can get that like that?
Like that.
So, absolutely. Yeah, so obedience is not so much in general talking of you need to listen to any man, because women need to be selective in the men they choose to follow. Because if you pick the wrong man, then that can have a detrimental effect to your whole entire life. So I encourage women to seek some type of therapy or some type of coach to help them identify who they're really looking for and to help find those type of men. Because we have these bad boys, right, where they look good on paper. They look good, you know, just, you know, from seeing, like, they might have six pack, they might have, you know, money, but at the same time, do they care about you, right? Do they want to
see you grow? Do they respect you? Do they truly admire you? Yes. I think, you know, more than love, you know, thank you for bringing this so openly out, because not many men would want to talk, because this is very controversial, what we just, you know, spoke about. So thank you, first of all, for bringing this out. And you were so true when you said that why would men commit if they are getting everything just like that? Mm-hmm. And women have the option to deny or to give in, but to the right men, of course. Mm-hmm. And you can be in a relationship without love also, but they need to be mutual respect for each other, which I believe is most important, even more than love.
Right.
You can sustain in a relationship without love also, but if you don't respect each other, that relationship cannot survive at all. If you are undermining each other, it will be only a few days before, you know, you are out of the relationship.
Yeah,
so
definitely.
True, absolutely.
And another point is about love. When we look at relationships and they're going through the, you know, divorce or separation, you don't hear anyone talking about in the divorce court saying they want half their love back. They want half of material things, money, you know, finances, 401ks, cars. They want that because they have grown to say, well, the love is not there, the respect is not there, so I'm just going to take what I can. Right. So now they're going to be operating under a very materialistic sense where they believe, OK, these material things are going to make me happy, because then if I have them, he doesn't have them or she doesn't have them, and then suffering occurs. But it doesn't happen in every relationship, but definitely in the majority, where the other person is so adamant about ruining someone's life, where they're saying, well, I'm going to take everything you have. And if I can do that, then I'll feel satisfied. But how long will that satisfaction last? And it's going to depend on the person, of course. But typically, when we deal with happiness is very short lived, right? Our emotions last 90 seconds, right? Our mental last 90 seconds. If they last longer than 90 seconds, it's because you're thinking about it, right? You're ruminating about it. So the human body in general, or the human mind in general, is going to naturally be negative. So it's going to naturally ruminate on negative things longer than it would positive things. So this positive victory you get is going to be good for a short period of time, but the negatives that happen after, those are probably going to be greater than your short win. And I'm not saying that you shouldn't get a divorce or you shouldn't get out of a relationship. For me, the premise of getting a divorce or a separation is if you're in a toxic relationship, whether he mentally abuses you or physically abuses you, or he's no longer able to give you the life that he he promised you in a sense, right? So let's say he was someone who was driven, he was motivated, and you were willing to build with him. And all of a sudden he's like, well, I don't want to do that anymore because I failed and I got knocked down and it hurt and I'm scared. And he refuses. This is a key. This is key here. He refuses to get back up. Then it is, in my opinion, it is okay to leave him, because if he's refusing to help himself, how can you help him?
Yes. Absolutely. I agree. So another thing, I mean, we have almost come to like 50 minutes of our show. I have a lot of questions still, but kind of running out of time. So I'll not ask you one more question before we move ahead to our next round, Michael. Mm-hmm. And this is like a signature question that I ask my guests. So do you believe in limitlessness? I know you already spoke about it a bit. And who, according to you, has achieved that limitlessness in this life? Who, according to you, are those people? It can be one, two, three, however many you feel. So what is your take on this?
So I believe that as long as we have the mindset of that there's more to give, there's always going to be more to give. Right. If you believe that you can get back up, whether you got knocked down good or you got just kind of pushed and shoved down or pushed back, there's always an opportunity for you to overcome. So becoming limitless, or to become under the mindset of trying again, that's always there. Right. You can always get back up. Right. It's your choice to stay down or to get back up. Yeah. And as for someone who has reached that type of mindset, that's a wonderful question. I typically don't think of that question quite often, but if I had to think of a person, it would be one of the greats, whether it be like Mother Teresa, Gandhi, those people come to mind, where look at that, like how much they had to go through, right? Yes. Whether it be poverty, not being able to eat meals, the struggle, right? They struggled. Like if you look at pictures of them, like they're, you know, and some pictures, they're skin and bones, and they still had a smile on their face. And that smile is, you know, rings true past all the negativity and all the issues that they had to go through. So being limitless in the sense of, no matter what goes on in my life, they're still good. And if they could still smile, you know, that is someone to be respected and, you know, be renowned in the sense of being limitless.
Wonderful. Thank you so much, Michael. We will move on. I had a lot more that I wanted to ask, but maybe, you know, you will come again on the show after the 100 episodes are over, and we will talk more at that point. So let's move on to the next one. And that's going to be like a quick lightning bolt round where, you know, short, crisp answers. Okay, let's move on. Okay, so what are the top three qualities that you think every woman should have?
I believe they should be motivated. They should have goals. So like motivated in the sense of pushing, goals to have ambitions, and then they should be feminine.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Your top three qualities desirable to be limitless?
I would say you need to be positive, you need to have a plan, and you need to understand what you don't want in your life.
Okay, wonderful. Your most favorite hobby or a time pass when you're free, what do you love doing?
I love going to the gym, so that would be it.
Okay, so you love working out, basically.
Yes.
Okay, great. I mean, I'm glad that's your hobby. So you basically are able to kill, you know, two birds with the same stone.
Yes, exactly.
Yeah, great. Your dream life in three lines.
In three words?
Three lines or three words. Yeah, if you can wrap it up in three words, I don't mind.
Never give up.
Perfect. Perfect. Which person has impacted you the most in your life?
I would say my brother.
Okay. Do you want to kind of give a reason?
Oh, of course. So when I was in college, I had a good life, right? I was able to get A's, high honors, and I had money, girls, right? Not a problem, right? Everything a college kid thought they need, you know, thinks they need.
Right.
And I remember he came into my room one day and he said, "Hey, I have this movie I want you to watch." And I'm like, "I don't want to watch a movie with you." And he goes, "Well, just come watch this movie with me and then I'll never ask you to watch another movie in your whole entire life." I was like, "Oh, that's a pretty good deal." So, but before he did that, he asked if I was happy. And I said, "Of course I'm happy. I have girls, I have money, I have good grades. I'm like, why wouldn't I be happy?" And then after I watched a movie, and the name of the movie was Peaceful Warrior, and it just opened up my mind. It helped me realize that there was something else besides the money and the good grades
and having
being
fun.
Able to, yeah, and having fun. So he was the person who kind of put the key in the lock, and then it helped me understand I needed to turn it.
Wow. He was the one who ignited that, I think.
That fire, yeah.
That, yeah. Wonderful, wonderful. The best advice you ever received from someone?
The best advice I've ever received was from an executive from General Motors. Him and I had went out for lunch, and he told me, or he asked me if I was willing to work harder than I've ever worked in my whole entire life. And I was like, I'm working pretty hard. And he goes, "You don't understand." He's like, "If you don't have the life you want right now, it's because you're not working hard enough." So that always rings true to me.
Wow. Lovely. What legacy do you want to leave for the coming generations?
The legacy I would like to leave is that never is only an option. Right? There's nothing impossible. If you believe it's possible, then it can happen. So don't allow someone to say something's impossible and to operate on their beliefs, because what limits them doesn't have to limit you.
Absolutely. Beautiful. One habit that you're working on to change in yourself?
Definitely to be more affectionate, right? For me, I'm very hardworking and I'm so work focused where sometimes I can forget to call my mom or call my grandmother. And now I'm starting to pay more attention to that. And just to be able to, you know, call my mom and say, "Hey, how you're doing?" Or call my dad and say, "How you're doing?" Just family members in general.
Mm-hmm. Lovely. Great that you realize that and you're already working on that.
Mm-hmm.
What's your favorite food?
My favorite food? Probably like pizza.
Okay. Nice. A typical Italian pizza?
I like margarita.
Okay.
Yeah.
So are you a cheese person?
Yeah, like cheese with basil, garlic. So, yeah, it's going to be good.
Yeah, wonderful. Have you taken your vaccine? Yes, no, and why?
No, and I'm not going to be taking the vaccine for the reason being that I'm a very healthy person, and the human body in general is the best source of a combatant to any bacteria or virus that it will come, you know, in contact with. So to mess with the human, you know, immune system for me is silly, because all the people who are getting COVID and recovering who didn't get the vaccine, they're fine. The mortality rate for COVID is so low where I'm not concerned. There's actually a higher mortality rate for driving cars than COVID. So, okay. I mean, I should be more worried about driving a car.
But, you know, just one more question related mm-hmm. to that. If they don't allow you to travel maybe within US or maybe internationally without showing that you are vaccinated, what would you do?
So money talks. And no matter what a country does or an airline does, you can always charter a flight into a country and charter a flight out of a country. So for me, I already started to implement plans of maybe even starting my own charter services, like to make your own airline, and then to kind of do what the vaccine people are doing. Like, they're mandating people to get vaccines, and the airline that I would create would be for only unvaccinated passengers. So I was thinking about doing something like that.
Wow. You're thinking long and, you know, so much further.
Yeah.
Awesome. So just on that note, you know, I want to leave saying that even I have not gotten myself vaccinated and I don't believe in being vaccinated. Same thoughts, exactly the same, you know, process of thinking. And I support you in that. So one last message, Michael, that you want to leave the audience with, because I think, you know, in one of your blogs, I read that something related to basically what is the prize in life for us? That was the blog that you had, and where you wrote that the prize in life for us is to reach a life that was predetermined for us. So do you think there is something that is predetermined for all of us, and does everyone reach there? And what is your last message to the audience?
Okay. So this operates under the realm of understanding that you have a purpose in your life. Because if you have a purpose, then that means you have a destination also. Because you can say, well, my purpose is to, you know, help others become more resilient, right? To be limitless. But what is the end goal, right? How many people do you want to affect, influence? And so the prize of life is to reach that person you were always destined to be. And for me, it's like in the afterlife, whether you were religious or whether you believe in the afterlife, maybe you don't, but let's say you do. And let's say the creator is face to face with you and he hands you a folder of all the things you could have done in your life and all the things you should have done, because he gave you the ability to do that. And then he says, this is what you accomplished. And it's only half the size of what you could have accomplished. Mm. So then he asks you the question, why have you not fulfilled what I gave you the ability to do? And that's powerful, because you have so much more to give, but you're only willing to put in this much work, right? So there's 60% about more to give every single day that people are just not giving. So if you can tap into that 60%, if you can tap into being, you know, limitless, where you're saying, I have more to give, and I'm not going to stop until I give everything I have, every ounce of me. So you know, just telling people the prize of life is reaching your destined place. And that destined place is going to be something you have to look on the unconscious level, where it's like, okay, where do I really want to be? Where do I really want to be? Because if you're happy where you are and you're complacent there, okay, right? I'm not here to say you need something. But at the same time, it's like, but you can have this. And I've been making a point of giving people money, right? So let's say you ask me for a dollar and I say, here's a dollar. So Anshu, you have a dollar. I said, Anshu, I have $100 bill. Here you go. You said, no. I only need this $1. But I said, but you have this $100 bill here. I'm trying to give you. No, I'm fine. And just the premise of that type of thinking, right? You have what you got. Right. Life gave you a dollar. You got what life, you know, you asked life to give you. You got a dollar. But then I'm saying you can get $100 now.
Yes.
Here you go. And you're saying, no, I'm resilient to that.
I'm complacent and I'm satisfied with this $1.
Exactly. So if you can understand that there's more to get, right? Life is full of abundance, right? You should have an abundance mindset where you say, all right, I can get this, right? There's not a limited amount of success for it, you know, for people. There's not a limited amount of money. There's an infinite amount of money in the government, and especially in America, has proven that they can keep printing money until the printing presses break. So there's only what you allow to be a limit. Then if you can say, okay, there's no limit, then there's going to be no limit.
Yes, absolutely. So is that your last message to the audience before you leave them?
You want me to add a little bit more?
If you have any something else that you want to add.
Okay. Yeah. Just the last bit would be to take some time out today and to write down the things you want to accomplish in your life. And then if you're with someone, to write down another list of things you want to accomplish with them together in their life. And to keep going on until you tapped into all the people who are important to you, whether it be a child, a friend, a family member, and to make that list a priority, because that's where joy is going to come from. And if your life is filled with joy, you're going to be more motivated to give more every single day. Because if I simply say to give more and you have nothing to look forward to, you're not going to push yourself. But if you have dreams and aspirations that are clear and definitive, you're going to be more prone and likely to succeed and accomplish them.
Absolutely. Lovely message, Michael. Thank you so much. And thank you so much for all your time.
No problem. Thank you so much.
It was an amazing session. I had a wonderful time, and you have a great day ahead.
Thank you so much, Anshu, everyone. Please like, follow, subscribe, Anshu, if you're just joining in today. She has some wonderful content, and you can learn so much from her.
And Michael's, all the links are there in the description. You can follow him and connect with him on his website and all the social media handles that are given in the description. So great, Michael. Thank you so much. Bye-bye.
Thank you.
Take care. We'll
all right,
see
bye.
Again. Bye-bye.